This is Ask GMBN Tech, our weekly show, where we get to talk about Mantua tech-related stuff. So if you guys have got any questions at all, anything you want to know, fire your questions into the email address on the screen there, or you can add yours in the comments below this video. So first up is from Daniel. After watching Neil's video over on GMBN the other day about how fast you can go on a mountain bike, it got me thinking. Are hubs made with a safe maximum speed in mind? Just how fast can your average hub go for a continuous time? To be honest, I'm not actually sure. And I'm pretty sure that mountain bike hubs don't really have that as a factor in them because they're designed to cope with the stresses of mountain bike riding as opposed to the speed and the friction and what would happen if you go to a high speed, like the same sort of testing you might see using cars. I honestly can't see speed being that much of a problem on a mountain bike because it's pretty rare anyone's going to be getting over that speed that Neil did. And even then, his bike coped with it like it was nothing. It was just a walk in the park, really, for that bike. So really, if you look at the structure of a hub, you've basically got the shell, you've got the cassette mechanism, you've got the four bearings, normally four bearings in it, and the axle running through it. So really, one of the only things that could go wrong would be the bearings collapse, and that would only happen if your bearings are in bad condition to start with. And even if they did collapse, the axle is still going to continue rotating around the inside. I mean, granted, your bearings are going to disintegrate, so it's not going to be in a nice sort of state of affairs on the inside, but really, there's not a lot to go wrong with the hub. The bigger things that can go wrong with the hub would be the hub shell cracking itself, but that wouldn't happen from speed. That's more likely to happen from something like slope style or maybe something the way that Blake rides quite aggressively, or something in relation to the torque that goes through the drive mechanism. So I think you're pretty safe on a mountain bike with the sort of speed you're going to be doing, but I will ask a few manufacturers out there just to see if there is a stance on how that they do their testing. I know that some brands are quite open with that and other brands just don't want to reveal how they do their testing, but I'll come back to you maybe on a weekly show when I've heard back from a few brands. All right, next up is from Jack Ammerman. Ask GMBN Tech, I want to go tubeless, but my current tyres, which are non-tubeless ready, still have 90% tread life left on them. Could I still run tubeless with these? I don't really want to spend too much and buy new tyres. Yeah, absolutely. As long as your tyres are in pretty good condition, you can set them up tubeless whenever you want. Just pay attention and make sure there aren't any sort of slices or slashes that you haven't noticed, because you could be running an inner tube in there and not actually notice that. But when you set up tubeless the first time, you might lose quite a lot of sealant until it plugs that hole. And if it's a big slash, it might not ever actually plug it. So just make sure the inside of that carcass is nice and easy to set up. And you're good to go. I'm just going to throw you to a video. In fact, it's got a little clip on screen of how to set up your tyres tubeless. Nice, good video to follow. The link to that is going to be in the description below this video. Getting one half of the tyre onto the rim, and then you want to be putting some sealant into the tyre before you finish putting the tyre onto the wheel completely. Make sure your sealant is really well shaken up so the particles are suspended within the fluid, and then pour in the amount that you need for your size tyre, and then spin that round and then start getting the rest of the tyre bead back in place. Next up is from Joseph Stalin. Not sure if you still own it, but how was your nukeproof Scout race? I'm thinking of picking one up myself. Yeah, it's a great bike. To be honest, it's been neglected lately because I just simply haven't had enough time riding a bike. I've done a bit of e-biking recently, been riding the Scott quite a lot and my other nukeproof, but not the Scout too much. I do need to sort of give it a bit more love. But no, it's a really good bike. So it's obviously available in two setups, the 27.5 or the 29. I've got a 29-inch wheel version, which is a little bit heavier just because the wheels are a bit on the more budget end, so they're quite heavy when they're in 29s, but they're really, really strong. The only thing I've just been a little bit frustrated with, I've not managed to get the fork exactly the way I like it. I did toy around with making some sort of plastic air volume spaces because they don't accept the normal ones you can get from RockShox for the more expensive forks. So I've not been able to get the fork quite right, but considering the price, I think the bike's really, really good and the geometry is brilliant on it. Great, great bike to start with, a really good bike to sort of upgrade and grow with as you own it as well, because the frame is great, geometry is bang on. Next up's from MTBST. Hi Doddy, I've got a 2018 Canyon Spectral AL6, which has got a Pike RC fork on it. I was thinking, is it worth upgrading to the RC T3? I do quite a bit of racing and I want to do more. I'm also an advanced rider and tackle double blacks frequently. Cheers. Well, my answer to you would be like, do you feel like there's a problem with the RC damper on there? So the RC damper is a really basic one. It's a dial basically, so it can be like more or less locked out, fully open and somewhere in the middle, although it's quite hard to get an exact setting because it's got like an infinite sort of dial there. whereas the RCT3 has got high and low speed compression adjustable independently, so it's a different kettle of fish altogether. Now, that's a much more advanced damper, and it is a lot better, to be fair. However, there's nothing wrong with that RC. I think they work really well, and sometimes the simplicity of them is great. I had that on both of my previous nuke-proof 29ers, and no problem whatsoever with it. Something I did find with it though myself was I found it spiked a bit if you had too much damping on, and what that means is basically the fork, you feel a sharp sort of impact through the fork where the damper can't actually react to that in time, so you get part of that shock through to you. So obviously the RC is great, it works, but if you're noticing it feels a bit limited, you might want to upgrade to the RCT3. But there is another option, and that's just to get your fork as it is, to get it tuned. That way you can get it to feel exactly the way you want with all the support that you need. There's a lot of suspension tuners around. There's the guys at Fox UK for Fox related forks. There's TF Tuned. There's Sprung and the Forrester Dean. There's loads in Europe and US and all over the place. And those guys can really get the best out of a fork to suit you. So it's definitely worth looking at that option too. A creak related one from the Timcat. Help, my sea rails are noisy. What's the best way to silence it? All right, so Tim, there's a few different things this could be. So firstly, you need to look at the seat clamp interface. So sometimes you get a single bolt that goes through. We have these little plates that go on the outside that holds the saddle rails. You get other ones that have got a twin bolt design that have a cradle in the underneath and a clamp on the top that clamps down. Check all of the bolts, make sure they're clean, make sure they're greased. Check the clamps as well, all the surfaces. Check anything there and make sure you've tightened everything to the correct torque setting, which will be written on those bolts or on the clamps themselves. Definitely check that because they do creak, and it's really easy for that to happen if you've been riding your bike for a long time, especially if there was any grease there, it's been washed away and it's all a bit dry. That sort of thing can happen, so check that. Also, the actual rails itself have been known to creak within the clamps, when the clamp clamps on. So you can use an assembly compound there because that's really good. Once you set your position, it's not a moving part. So actually assembly compound helps a bit of adhesion, it helps it not move. So that's another cause of creaking. And the last one, and if it's this one, then I feel sorry for you because this can be really annoying, is where the saddle rails sort of penetrate the base of the seat and actually hold into place. Now, if they can move around at all in any way, they're gonna creak. Now, there's a few things you can do to stop this. I mean, the obvious one is to make sure it's clean, see if there is any movement, and use a bit of lubricant, like some spray lube, WD-40, something like that might help. I've heard of people doing that one before. And I have heard of people actually trying to fill that sort of void so there can't be any movement in there. I've heard of people squirting in like silicon bathroom, seen that and all sorts of stuff. But if I was you, I would just try the lube version first. And also check that it's not actually damaged, because I've had it before when one's been loose on an old bike of mine, and actually you could pull the whole top of the saddle straight off the rails, and that's why it was creaking. If that's the case, time for a new saddle, mate. Next up is from DILUTEDUK. Dolly, loving the show. I've got a Voodoo Hardtail 29er, which says on the frame and the website that's designed by mountain bike legend Joe Murray. I'm fairly new to the sport and know nothing about him, so could you maybe give me a brief history lesson? Yeah, Joe Murray is an absolute legend. Actually, I went on a ride with Joe Murray in Moab a few years back now for a Voodoo press camp. And that was really cool getting to ride with him because, well, as you say, he is a legend. So Joe Murray was in mountain biking from the very beginning. He was a very, very good cross-country racer to start with. And I think in the early days, as early as like 81, 82, he was already riding for Gary Fisher as one of his team riders, doing a lot of development work, and used to basically win everything. I'm pretty sure he was a Norba champion like twice. So that's like North America, sort of like their national championship, basically. He won that twice, the cup champs and the overall, as far as I know. And he also did something crazy. He won like 12 races back to back on like the high level cross country, which I'm fairly sure no one's even matched today by these dates. You know, we've got people like Nino Scherter, who's just mind blowingly good, but not sure if he's done that 12 back to back like that. Anyway, so Joe went on after Fisher to work for a lot of bike companies out there. So one of those was Marin, or Marin, as you might know it. Now, he actually was right at the beginning when he started the company with Bob Buckley, and he actually spec'd all the bikes and designed a whole number of those bikes, including the first, or arguably the first, titanium production mountain bike, which was the Marin Team Titanium. Now, when it came out, that was just incredible because it's such a futuristic metal for mountain bikes to use, bearing in mind that everything back then was steel. So to have this like wonder material that had that inherent flex, but it was super light and it wouldn't corrode, it was pretty mind-blowing. bit of time, I think. Like, the price was like $2,800, and it came out and it shocked the industry because no one had seen a bike even like half that cost at the time. So it's pretty mental. Then after Marin, he went on to Kona, and of course he did all the Kona series of bikes, their famous sloping top tube on them, aggressive head angles. He designed their Project 2 and Track 2 forks. The Track 2 had like a proper crown, bolted crown style system on there. He designed all their maximum reaction and velocity and equilibrium tyres, which were front and rear specific tyres. Bigger tyre up front, a bit more float on it, a bit more aggression for cornering and braking. The tyre out back always had a bit more of a paddle profile for forwards, like propulsion. There's a whole bunch of stuff he designed with them. Just amazing, really, a lot of innovation. Now, he went on to Voodoo after that, and he's done a whole bunch of other stuff in the middle. Now, he's one of the industry's leading sort of product testers. So behind the scenes, he tests, he'll sign loads of NDAs, non-disclosure agreements, basically. So he tests for other manufacturers. And one of the things he's been doing, like from the beginning, he's been one of Shimano's product testers. Joe's work doing the Shimano product testing was literally riding all these new products before they came, right, long before they would go to market, basically to see how they wear, see what the ergonomics are like, see what it's like in day-to-day life. Now, the American side of that business was known, I think the Americans called it that, Skunk Development. And I think they took that name from Lockheed, who used to have the Skunk Works program for the SR-71 Blackbird. Just a cool little bit of trivia for you there. I would 100% say he is an absolute legend. And just so you know how much of a legend he is, he was inducted into the MTB Hall of Fame in 1988. And in that year, he was inducted into it. Alongside him was Gary Fisher, Charlie Kelly, and Joe Breeze, basically the three founding fathers of mountain biking. There was also Charlie Cunningham, Tom Ritchie, who used to make all those early Fishers, Jackie Feeler, and Mike Signard. Mike Signard, to you and me, he's Mr. Specialized. So that just shows you how much of a legend Joe Murray is. Okay, last but not least, quite a techie one here from Whom and Him. Loving all the GMBN shows, especially tech. I've learnt loads from you. I've built up a Freeride 26-inch wheel bike with a 65.5-degree head angle. Nice. Currently, it's got a RockShox Boxer downhill fork with a 42mm offset. I wanted to change the fork to a 27.5-inch wheel pike, RockShox pike, that is, with 160mm. Will it break the headset if it goes on? I intend to ride hard, etc. The bike basically pedals like an XC bike, and I use it like an all-rounder, but it's really heavy with that fork on it. So should I go for a 42mm offset 27.5 fork instead of a dual crown 26? Will it be as strong, and should I do it? First thing to ask, why the 27.5? I'm guessing you just think that it might not be 26. I'm fairly sure there are some 26s still in that spec. But if you'd just rather go for the 27.5, yeah, that would be absolutely fine. It's a really modernized fork, so I don't think you're gonna have any issues with breakages or anything like that. But just so you know this, a twin crown fork is always going to be stronger because there's more support. There's more overlap on the inner and outer legs. The inner legs are a lot longer. They're supported by twin sets of crowns on there. It's just a much stronger and more overbuilt fork. But like you point out, it's really heavy, so it's not gonna do your bike too much good. But yeah, you could definitely put the same offset 27.5 on there, maximize on that, and 160mm travel is gonna feel amazing as well. Brand new fork like that compared to an older Boxer. Boxers are great, don't get me wrong, but the new fork tech we see these days is just so, so good out of the box. There we go, that's another Ask GMBN Tech Clinic in the bag. For a couple more great videos, click down here for the first in our Essentials series. It's all about going back to basics. And click down here if you need 5 reasons to go tubeless. It also tells you a lot about why tubeless is so good and how you need to put it on your bike. Keep those questions coming in, get them into the comments, get them into the email address on the screen at the beginning of the show there. And as always, click on the round globe to subscribe to GMBN Tech. We love having you here. If you like GMBN Tech, give us a thumbs up.